Hi, good morning everyone, and welcome to worship. So as we join together in lots of different places, but united by God and by faith, let's sing our first hymn, I Am a New Creation.
On growing here in the grace of God, I'll stand and I will praise you, Lord. Yes, I will praise you, Lord, and I will sing.
So we come to a time of prayer. Let's pray. Loving God, we gather to worship you, separated by space, but united by our faith and your love. We offer you our worship with thankful hearts, recognizing that even in troubled times, we are so deeply blessed to be part of your church family, knowing that you care for us, knowing that people care for us, knowing that all things are in your faithful hands. We're here to sing, to listen, to speak, to reflect, to rest in your presence. We're here to celebrate your love and rejoice in your amazing grace. We're here to remind ourselves afresh of your purposes and your unfailing mercy. So, loving God, we thank you and we praise you. Great and wonderful God, receive all that we bring you now. For we offer it gladly and reverently in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we continue with with our prayer of confession. And when I say, when we have forgotten your love, will you join me in saying, Lord, forgive us. Lord, we brood over our problems and fret about the future, forgetting that whatever may come, you will support and strengthen us. You are sufficient for all our needs. When we have forgotten your love, Lord, forgive us. We envy others, coveting what we don't have, our thoughts fixed on earthly gain rather than spiritual fulfillment. When we have forgotten your love, Lord, forgive us. We fritter away your many gifts, taking them for granted, exploiting them with no thought of tomorrow, or too preoccupied with other concerns to appreciate them fully. When we have forgotten your love, Lord, forgive us. We deny ourselves the joy of your presence, neglecting time for prayer and worship, ignoring the world, wandering from your side. When we have forgotten your love, Lord, forgive us. Gracious God, forgive us our foolish ways and teach us to celebrate all that you have given and all that you will yet give. And may we have confidence in your forgiving nature, knowing that you always offer us a fresh start. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Reading from Genesis chapter 18, verses 1 to 15. The three visitors. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and then you may all wash your feet and rest under this tree. Let me get you something to eat, so you can be refreshed, and then go on your way, now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered, "do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get three seers of the finest flour and knead it and bake some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While they ate, he stood near them under a tree. "Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There, in the tent," he said. Then one of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him. Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have a child now that I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord?' I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, "I did not laugh." But he said, "Yes, you did laugh." Thanks be to God for his word.
Abram and Sarai are portrayed in the Bible as models of faith. God commands them to go from their home to a new land, and they go. Huge risk takers, because they trusted God and were confident that, however unlikely it was, if they trusted God and made scary and risky decisions for God, then all would be well. So they go to the new land, and the years pass. Yet despite their bravery and faith and service, God had not delivered what God had promised. So they must have been thinking, come on, God, we've served you so well. Now where's that blessing you promised us? Sarai had not had the promised child. Abram saw no possibility of being the ancestor of a multitude of nations as promised. They were still childless, and now they're very old. In desperation, Sarai gives up on God's promises and gives her Egyptian slave girl, Hagar, to be a surrogate wife, so that at least her husband would have an heir, and Ishmael is born. Sarai had been a good, faithful woman, but now she had stopped trusting God and made a very dubious decision. And even faithful Abram seemed more than happy to have a child with his wife's servant rather than trust God. So had God got it wrong, thinking that he could rely on their faith? Well, they did let God down, despite their deep and powerful faith. So what hope is there for any of us? Should God trust us to be faithful enough to do the right thing, trusting God? I think the point is that God sees the real person behind the mask that we might put on. So warts and all, God sees us for what we are. Sometimes faithful and sometimes not. And that means that God knows we have the potential to let God down, but also sees the amazing potential in us to do good things for God. Sometimes we struggle to see it ourselves. And even knowing that we are so far short of perfection, God calls us and invites us to go on a journey of faith with God that can make our lives better and the world better. So to Abram, God said, go, take your wife and nephew, but leave everything and everyone else and trust me to lead you to something good. Well, they did trust God to a point. Just like the apostles in the New Testament, at times each of them showed amazing faith, and at times they showed a bewildering lack of faith. Just like us in the modern church, capable of amazing faith and capable of such weak faith. The point is that God has looked deep into our hearts and has seen something good. The Holy Spirit has breathed into us and called us to a life of faith with God, trusting God, following God, going where God leads us, journeying every step of the way with God. At times, things go so well that faith's easy. We feel so good worshipping and serving God, and life feels great. But then, just as we think all is going just perfectly, life has a habit of slapping us in the face and knocking us back. Like when a pandemic comes along and causes so much distress, and we question God, and we get angry with God, and we might worship and pray less often, and we might hold back our service and gifts. Our faith and trust in God can be well weakened. Sometimes all we can muster is apathy, the great plague that is killing so many churches. Our sometimes strong and determined faith can suddenly become so fragile and weak, but we remember these biblical characters. Abram saw no great potential in himself, but God saw it, and despite all his failings and his weaknesses and his inconsistent faith, God had chosen the right man after all. Abram, renamed Abraham, was the one who would father the nations. Sarai, renamed Sarah, has the long-promised child, Isaac. So what does God see in the church today? I think God sees people who sometimes come running when Christ calls, and sometimes crawl reluctantly forward, who sometimes take a step forward and sometimes take a step backwards. God sees a people who at times have a strong and glorious faith that lifts them up to the highest heights, and a people who at times have a faith so weak and so fragile that even joining the church family in worship can feel like a chore, so hard to do. God sees a people who at times cannot do enough for God, and at other times are so reluctant to do anything at all for God. A people who take risks and make great sacrifices for God, and at other times will hold back and take little interest in what God wants. God sees a people who can be breathtakingly generous, and at other times, not so much. The human condition. Strong and weak, faithful and unfaithful, risk-taking and reticent. Yet God chooses us, calls us, and walks the journey of life and faith with us, helping us to build something good, trying to guide us along the right paths. If God only wanted perfect people, the churches would be long since empty. We each have different strengths and weaknesses. We're each in a different place in our journey with God, each unsure about how much to trust God and how much of ourselves and our lives to give to God. In other words, we're just like all the Christians who have gone before us. And as this lockdown slowly starts to be loosened, the churches are at a major point in our history. Will we embrace a new normal and a new future, rebuilding and maybe building something better than before? Or will we give up and stop trusting God? So friends, whether you are 100 days old or 100 years old, you have been called to come and follow Christ. You've been called to offer God all that you have and all that you are so that you can meet your great potential. God is blessed when we respond most fully as our circumstances and health allow. After all, wasn't it the woman in a Bible story who had virtually nothing to offer, but still offered what she had anyway? Wasn't she the person that Jesus admired most? A prayerful and honest life centered on kindness and love is the greatest gift we can offer God. When we see that faith is about relationship and working at it, and when we give ourselves more fully to that relationship with God, we then discover how blessed we are. The more we give, the more we find we've already received. The more we hold back, the greater our doubts become. Passages like today's challenge us to rethink our relationship with God. I've experienced how God can transform a life. He transformed mine. I've seen how God can bring new life to church communities. So I don't think God's a bad judge of character. We may doubt what we're capable of by ourselves and together, but God has seen the potential that's there and has said to each of us by name, "Come, follow me." So may we have the wisdom to listen to God, to understand, and to step boldly forward in faith. Amen. And let's sing the hymn, "I, the Lord of Sea and Sky."
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I? I will go, Lord. I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I?
So we come to our prayers of intercession. When I say, but most of all we pray, I invite you to join me in saying, Your will be done. Loving God, ask, you said, and you shall receive. And so we do ask. We ask that in this troubled world, hearts may be transformed, that peace may be seen as better than war, that blessings may be shared, that the oppressed may be freed, that justice may reign. But most of all, we pray, Your will be done. We ask that in Your church, hearts may be transformed, that we might seek true unity and never reject our sisters and brothers in Christ, that we may become more fully disciples, that we might listen and respond to Your calling, that we might find courage to take leaps of faith. But most of all, we pray, Your will be done. We ask that in our lives we may think, speak, and act in accordance with Your will. To the sick, the injured, the sad, the lonely, the lost, may You bring peace and strength. To those beginning a journey of faith, and those whose journey is proving hard, bring courage and wisdom. To those who grieve, bring comfort. To those in need, may You reach out with love. But most of all, we pray, Your will be done. We ask that we may know always of Your steadfast love in our lives, May we feel your presence in good times, bad times, and ordinary times. May our faith be strong and our lives a witness to your grace and mercy. Help us to praise you wherever we are, whatever we do. But most of all, we pray, your will be done. To God and God alone be the glory, now and forever. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. And let us join in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so we come to our next hymn, Will You Come and Follow Me? And if you're following it in the Singing the Faith hymn book, we don't sing verse 3. Will you come and follow me?
Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my name be known? If I but call your name, will you care for cruel and kind and never be the same? Will you risk the hostile stare? Should your life attract or scare? Will you let me answer prayer in you and you in me? Will you love the summons echo true when you would call my name? Let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you in me.
So may God's powerful love fill us all with confidence and trust, and may God's blessing be upon us and all whom God loves forever. Amen.
I search the world, faith.